Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. And this week, it's the March special subject, March Madness, let's call it. Minelli melodrama. Four big features. We'll be talking about the long, long trailer, the Cobweb, Some Came Running, and Home from the Hill. After all of that, the melodrama continues, because in Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto, we've got a little discussion for you of From Here to Eternity, which we saw at the TIFF Lightbox. It was the 70th anniversary screening, a restored version of that film. We do have it on the schedule for a few years from now, but we'll have a nice little teaser discussion for you at the end of this week's show.
So from the long, long trailer to Here to Eternity.
Let's just hear the little Malton paragraphs on these Minelli films. Long, long trailer. We gave this one 2.5 stars out of a possible 4.
That seems harsh.
Pleasant vehicle for Lucy and Desi on honeymoon with cumbersome trailer that creates havoc for the duo. Plenty of slapstick. Director Vincente Minelli and our cast, Lucille Ball, Desi Arnaz, Marjorie Main, Keenan Wynn, Gladys Hurlbut. Actually, really, most of those people are hardly in it. It's really just Desi and Lucy, and one person that's not even credited here, Moroni Olson, who is the interlocutor in the noirish framing sequence.
Not to mention the trailer.
Well, the trailer is a character in itself, no question.
Of all things that I might call this film, I think the last thing I would call it is pleasant.
No, it's pretty intense. Now, here's the backstory to our inclusion of this film.
Let me tell it.
Please, by all means. Let me tell part of it.
Okay.
As background, I like to have things on the TV with the sound off for the most part, because otherwise I get too distracted. For a long time, I had TCM on, just whatever was playing, just nice to look up occasionally and see some images there from the golden age of Hollywood. I had never seen the long, long trailer. It was just out of the corner of my eye one evening as we were, you know, getting our dinners ready and everything. Elise, you took a look at what was happening on the screen, and what did you see?
The impressions that I formed of the film by glancing at it while making dinner with the sound off, none of them turned out to be exactly right. We were watching the whole sequence where they're trapped in the rainstorm on the backcountry road, and for one thing I thought I was looking at slanty noir camera angles, but no, the whole trailer is slanted. That's what's going on there.
The visual effect is the same.
Yeah, I was like, wow, this stupid Lucy and Desi comedy, this is very artful. And you said, oh, well, Vincente Minelli directed it. And then the other impression I had watching it with the sound off is that they were having a very, very angsty time together, that this was going to be a movie about the relationship kind of falling apart. And that's not exactly true. They have these trials they go through, these repeated trials that they go through with the trailer. And when that happens, yes, they're very upset and they get very upset with each other, but it doesn't actually cumulatively erode the relationship. The relationship very much bounces back after all of these situations occur.
Okay, sure, but we mostly see the conflict. It is an angst-filled film.
But they don't end up hating each other or anything. They really do seem to have a, well, in certain ways, they have a fundamentally good relationship.
It's pretty close to hatred by the end. They pull back from it, but let's not get too far.
They pull completely back from it.
It does have a noir structure, right? It starts in this terrible storm in the middle of the night. Desi Arnaz in a trench coat looks like someone in a Private Eye film who's been through hell. I mean, he has been through hell.
He certainly has.
And he shows up at this sort of forlorn trailer park manager's shack, goes in and meets not the manager. He's just not around. He meets an old cadre Roger Maroney Olson, who is all excited because he and the missus are going to buy a trailer for themselves, finally. They've been dreaming of it. And he's got this very soothing tone. That's what Maroney Olson usually did. He asks Desi Arnaz, fill me in on what's going on. Why are you so hot under the collar there, young sir? Desi just starts shrieking about what he's been through. And that's the story, basically. He's yelling the whole time. You have to imagine what we're seeing is what Maroney Olson is hearing about. And it's just a rough ride the whole time.
Yeah, I don't know how to explain the difference from what I was expecting and what I saw. I thought this would be a movie about a couple that kind of fundamentally hates each other, and they don't. They really don't. But on the other hand, they've got some terribly bad gender role issues going on in this marriage that more than anything is what's driving this conflict that the trailer just kind of manifests. What have we got here with this movie? We've got 1954, and we've got a satire of American consumerism already.
My tagline was, Mr. Blandings drives his dream house off the cliff. That's what I would have put on the poster, because it almost gets to that point. It has a lot of similarities with that kind of movie, right? Mr. Blandings builds his dream house, but this gets a lot more
terrifying,
tense. It's a close cousin of Father of the Bride, which is a domestic comedy that looks like a film noir and feels like a film noir at times.
Right, and of course that whole movie too is about the pressure put on the male protagonist by the expectation that he will foot the bill for this new lifestyle.
Right.
Although in this case, there's even more pressure put on because he's not just footing the bill, he's also hauling the trailer through the Sierra Nevada mountains.
Even trucking movies don't give you the visceral sense of how scary it is to drive a vehicle that size.
And you know what? That wasn't studio trickery. They really did it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they actually took a trailer up that path.
And for a person who has never driven, has never sat behind a wheel...
I don't know which would be more terrifying, if you have driven or if you haven't. But this reminded me, like that whole sequence, including beautiful scenery, reminded me of being driven through the Rocky Mountains many times by my grandparents, who used to take me on road trips to visit family in the summer when I was a child and a teenager. Sometimes my grandfather would be like, you know, we might die. And he was very, very, very tense. The dangerous mountain highway featured is Whitney Portal Road, which leads up to Mount Whitney in the Sierra Nevada Mountains in California.
The highest mountain.
The hairpin turn offers scenic views of the Owens Valley. During the scenes of Nikki and Tacy pulling their trailer in the mountains, their 1953 Mercury Monterey convertible is replaced with a larger but similar appearing 1953 Lincoln Capri convertible. So this was needed to pull the heavy New Moon trailer, this is the actual trailer used, up and over the steep grades of the Sierra Nevada, where the scenes were filmed. And other scenes were shot on the Pines to Palm Scenic Byway in Palm Desert, California.
Pretty incredible. These people put their lives on the line to bring us this entertainment.
Also, this movie did outgross Father of the Bride.
Really?
Also directed by Vincente Minelli.
Well, this is in the heart of the I Love Lucy era, so there was a lot of pre-sold interest.
Well, apparently the executives thought no one would pay money to see them. This is how early it is, I guess, in the TV to movie transfer.
Because they're like, well, they can see them anytime they want.
Every... For free! Yeah, but you can't see them giant in color. Color being a big thing. None of these movies are technically in Technicolor, because MGM didn't use Technicolor. They used a variety of Eastman Kodak processes.
Absolutely beautiful stuff.
So my first surprise was that Desi Arnaz is definitely the protagonist. The handful of I Love Lucy episodes I've seen, that is not the case.
It's all told from his perspective. He's narrating it, so it has to be.
Tacy is pressuring him into getting a trailer home. It's her idée fixe. He has some kind of salesman job or something that requires him to travel a lot. Oh, civil engineer.
Right.
Right. She wants to be with him all the time, so she has her heart set. Well, she's seen an ad for a trailer, so now this is going to be the solution to their problems. And he's got a budget in place for their first year of marriage. I mean, as so often in movies of this era, where you have to pretend that divorce doesn't exist and that people are virgins until they get married, these people are like way too old to be virgins on their first marriage, but anyhow, setting that aside.
Yeah, we just have to go with that.
Have to go with it. So yeah, they've got a first year budget because he's just starting out in his civil engineering career.
$1,700, and she says, hey look, $1,700 or just a little bit more. The rent we had allocated, we could just buy a trailer instead.
Just a little bit more. more.
Just a tiny bit more. They go to a trailer show. One gets the impression watching this film, this was a huge fad at the time. Everyone was getting excited about trailers.
Yeah, it doesn't exactly have the trashy Twin Peaks association with it. Well, I mean, my grandparents had a trailer that they drove to, after they retired, they drove it from, you know, the prairies, middle of the country, down to Arizona every year. It didn't look like this trailer, but I specifically remembered the scene where she's in the back trying to make dinner. I specifically remembered. I said to you, it's illegal. You can't do that. It's illegal. Because my grandfather had to explain that to me, because otherwise I would have just been riding in the trailer the whole time. Yeah, and then Lucy herself says that in the next scene.
But it was her idea. The trailer that she had picked out that was sort of in their price range, when they see it and its physical dimensions in front of them, they realize this is not.
No, it looks a little more like my grandparents' trailer. So not what you want as your primary home.
However, this trailer expo has many other options.
Including a long, long trailer. That's a great title, by the way. It's such a terrible joke. It's just perfect.
She says, well, let's just take a look. We're here. It doesn't do any harm. And she falls in love with it. It's exactly what she had hoped for when she saw the magazine layout of the other one. Turns out the down payment would be exactly what they can afford. She manages to convince him that they should do it.
Then we just get a significant sequence of there being all sorts of additional expenses that come with this decision beyond the fact that they have a mortgage on this thing now.
Yeah, so it starts with you just have to get something welded on so it can be towed.
Right.
They do all of that. That's costing a lot of money right there. Then the discovery is made that, well, their car is not going to be good enough. It won't be able to pull it anywhere. It's got to be a huge, heavy car in order to handle that kind of freight. So they've got to get their own giant car. And Desi Arnaz, I mean, that's it for the budget.
The first really great comedy sequence in this is the
driving lesson.
The driving lesson. The guy who works for this trailer hitch company who's going to instruct Desi in a very quick lesson on how to haul an enormous trailer around.
Trailer breaks first! It really gets into his head. He starts having nightmares about it, and of course he would, because this is your life and your new bride's life in your hands.
And maybe several people around you.
Absolutely. Half of the small towns that they drive through could be wiped out by this trailer. It's a great responsibility. He manages to get the hang of it. I mean, kind of miraculously, because it seems like it's not going to work.
But that's even more terrifying. The idea that this is how quickly people have to pick up.
Yeah.
Doing this kind of trick driving.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there should be a special license that you have to get overseen by the government.
Yeah, it's just, you know, it's just confidence. Or not even confidence, but just the necessity of having to do it that brainwashes him into thinking he can.
Yeah, and that's so much of what goes on in our society. A lot of people out there are doing things that they are not particularly qualified to do, and we just have to trust that they're not going to smash into us with their trailer or car, and sometimes that trust is misplaced. But in this case, you know, Desi Arnaz does manage to get them where they need to go. We have a brief glimpse of Keenan Wynn, who was third billed in this movie, and I was like, oh, well, he'll be back. He's a traffic cop. He never comes back. There's almost no characters in this. It's just the two of them on their odyssey.
Yeah, because it does just turn into this two-hander nightmare of growing tension. But after that driving lesson, what I feel for the whole rest of the movie is that Desi has, like, this trailer-sized amount of anxiety that he's just completely suppressed. But it's just looming there behind him the entire time.
Lucille Ball is just loving it. She's so excited. She's looking at the bright side of all of this stuff for so long. I mean, eventually it does start to get to her too. Her family takes some damage.
Well, none of the responsibility of any of this belongs to her.
One of the stops that they make, it's a huge set piece as well.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's a movie of set pieces.
They drive up and everyone's excited to see them and their trailer. They've got a parking space all set up for it in a long, long driveway.
The way the movie is set up, with these gender roles and identification position, we've come to see Lucy as just kind of the instigator of all of these problems and a contributor to them. Like, she always adds some extra problem on top as well. Here, she finally comes through for him. It looks like she's going to come through and they're going to work as a team, right?
Well, yeah, after a lot of damage is done. I mean, he tries to do it on his own. He's getting directions from 10 different people. He drives over some prized rose bushes and some trees, knocks down a fence or or two, but she takes control of the situation, barks orders at everyone.
I mean, this is what she's supposed to do as his helpmeet, as his fellow traveler, his navigator.
And she guides him in. He manages to get the trailer down that narrow lane. Unfortunately, at the end of it, there's a little overhanging roof. Some serious structural damage is done to the house.
Well, yeah, they take out like a side of this giant, ornate, small town, gracious house.
Huge destruction is wreaked upon this family.
And they don't get their check that was going to offset some of the cost of all of this. Their wedding present check.
It's all Desi's fault. Nobody's blaming Lucy.
He hasn't performed his role as a man.
No, he hasn't.
But the thing is, the way that still works as comedy is that he himself accepts that this is the role that he has to perform. He takes the challenge on himself.
Yeah, well, that's what men were doing for many, many years, and some of them are still doing it. Others have finally managed to give up, which is probably healthier.
I think it's obvious Minelli went into this thinking of Father of the Bride, and that became the coat rack for the whole idea, but it's turned into something more like a horror movie. Gargantuan monster trailer.
Father of the Bride is too, but this is Father of the Bride horror show on wheels, right?
I think all of that happens with the family after several sequences, including their first day at the trailer park.
That's one of the things that the movie gets into, right? Okay, you got this amazing freewheeling life, live anywhere, park anywhere, but no, that's not really true. If you want to use it as a home, it's really only able to function in that way in a trailer park. It needs to be connected.
And this trailer park is like they've joined some kind of polyamory cult, because these people are so into the trailer life. It's all that they want to think about, and they want to do it with their trailer friends. Everything has to be part of this community, so everybody's in everybody's business and helping out whether they want you to or not. And
significant, they're newlyweds. He wants to carry her over the threshold of the trailer, and nobody lets him.
Well, they don't want anyone to know that they want to fuck. That's also the reason that they were upset that there was a just married sign on the back of the trailer, because everybody that drives past them is cheering on sex.
Instead of that, they have to pretend that she's had a turned ankle situation, and she winds up getting roofied by Marjorie Maine and sent to bed to recover from this fictitious injury. That's it for the wedding night.
So this is a step too far for Lucy and Desi. They're willing to pay all this extra money, but they do not want to join the trailer park cult.
No, so they do decide at one point to drive way off the road and see what that's like. Even though they can't have a working refrigerator, you know, they can't do much in the trailer. They could have sex and they can cook things with gas, but no electricity. Unfortunately, they sink into a trough of mud.
Right, and so this is the wonky angled scene that I observed. Obviously, it's just like a lot of physical comedy of them sliding around, particularly Lucy, well, both of them ultimately, but she tries to rig up the coffee on the stove, like rig everything up so that she can continue to, because her whole objective is to perform her female role, which is to make this into a nice home and to cook for him.
Wherever they are, they're just gonna stick to it like the accountant in Heart of Darkness.
Pretty much. This is kind of a Heart of Darkness that they go into here. The Heart of the Darkness of the trailer in the wilderness. Wherever they go, they are trying, as you say, to recreate this advertisement of 1950s post-war consumer lifestyle.
Well, the sitcom white picket fence environment that you do get on TV if you stay home to watch them. But no, here they're out of their element. Is this marriage going to survive? Are they going to survive?
There's a pretty great sequence at the end that takes advantage of the two-bed joke. The fact that these newlyweds have to sleep in separate beds, and Lucy's is up higher, so she can't lie down in it. She keeps falling out of it.
Yeah.
I can't even remember how that gets resolved. Does she find a way to attach herself to the bed? I can't remember.
No, I think she just falls through the door at that point, right? And lands
in the mud. Oh, right. She, like, goes completely under the mud.
And then we cut away from there after they've been towed and they owe all kinds more money for that. So it's just one fiasco after another with this trailer.
What are the other memorable set pieces? Well, there's the woman driving one, yeah, which is identical to the joke in Claudia and David.
Pretty much. Just horribly reckless driving that goes perfectly well.
Lucy's performance is really great in this. She just seems like an utter psychopath. Maybe this would read differently depending on your gender at the time, but I don't see that we're given any indication that her driving would fail. He just thinks she's an alien. He just thinks she belongs to another species and he can't trust her at all.
Well, she's driving way too fast. I mean, once we see what she does, his fears are justified.
Yeah, but she seems like she might be able to pull this off is the thing.
Well, but it's totally illegal what she's doing. I mean, she's using the trailer as a weapon.
Well, I said she's a psychopath.
Yeah.
She does mention she's been driving in L.A. since she was 15, so...
I'll pull over. Don't worry. I can make it.
No, it's all the same jokes. But the most interesting thing to me about it was that they just seem like they're from different species during this sequence and that they're totally alien to each other in their way of relating to the world. This is like their biggest fight that happens after this. Like, she just puts the brakes on and gets in the back and says, okay, you go ahead and drive then. And then she won't speak to him for ages. And then after that, this is when she starts her canning obsession that ultimately turns out to be a big problem.
Well, the canning and her passion for rocks.
Yes.
Giant geodes.
Yeah, as soon as she collects that first giant rock to commemorate their travels, all the places they've traveled to, you know that this is going to turn into a problem.
Yeah, because so much of this movie really does force you to think about gravity, the massive weight that is trailing behind you, and she just keeps adding to it. More anxiety, more poundage.
The massive weight that is the white middle-class American male's lot in life. Great burden.
Every day of marriage just breaks your back a little more.
The other great comedy sequence is, as I was talking about before, when she's in the back trying to make dinner for him. Because again, it is this surrealist version of post-war middle-class America, right? Like, she's got all of the ingredients for the perfect meal from a magazine that she's read. Got her housewife's dress on, beautiful housewife's dress, and she's going to make this perfect meal for him, but they've decided that in order to do this right, she's got to start early and not just at the end of the day when they've been driving all day and they're exhausted, right? And then they're hungry and cranky.
Meal has to be ready as soon as Dad is through at the office.
Exactly. And then, yeah, obviously it's just her trying to prepare this meal while she's being tossed all over the place. The salad is being tossed just by the motion of the trailer.
There's admirable can-do spirit exhibited. She manages to keep it all together for quite a while. And she's hooking things on.
I think this is probably her best comedy.
Yeah, of course.
Sequence in the movie. She's really good in this.
Of course, eventually it gets to be too much for her. The cumulative impact of all the bumps in the road do a lot of damage, and there's no dinner left, and she's screaming.
It's a horror movie, like, you know, many of the best comedies.
They have another of their fights and they make up. They're still very far from their destination. And they have to ascend the mountain into high altitudes. And that's where things reach their crescendo.
Literally, climax is Greek for ladder, correct?
I think so.
So this is the climax.
So they have a big fight before going up the mountain because he tells her all the stuff you've put in the trailer going to make it impossible to actually use it to get where we need to go.
But again, they just cannot communicate here because for her, the entire purpose of having this trailer is to have a home.
Yeah, load yourself down with all of the accoutrements of middle class living and take them with you wherever you go. And he's just being a killjoy about it instead of taking seriously that this could create problems on their ascent. She just figures, if I hide everything, it'll work out anyway.
Again, she's becoming like a little psychotic about it.
Will not listen to reason, and it's his problem to make it all work out anyway. That, again, is the burden of the dad. He has to work with the material that he's given here and shape it like the master of the universe he is supposed to be. He's going around getting opinions, you know, can we just drive around the mountain? Well, you could take a 500-mile detour, but you can't even do it because it looks like he wants to do that. But no, bridges are washed out on it. There's no way except to go up the mountain.
You have to go through.
An old codger that is helping her with the unloading of the rocks and preserved fruit. He almost gets through to her, it seems like.
Yeah, but he can't because he can't put his foot down.
No.
She wants him to tell her that it'll be okay. And so that's ultimately what he does.
They bring it all back in and just hide it in various places.
Just to even distribute the weight, then maybe you have a chance of not dying.
Maybe.
But it really doesn't matter to her.
No, she's like, we're gonna do this.
We're gonna take this chance.
If we can't bring this stuff with us, then we may as well not live.
Basically.
Up they go, and the trailer is visibly pulling back on the car.
This Lucy character should be even more annoying than she is. I'm thinking, how would an audience react to her at the time? Well, she's played by Lucille Ball, so no one's gonna hate her.
No, she's lovable. I mean, they're used to this on TV too, right? This is the dynamic from I Love Lucy.
Yeah, but again, turned into...
It's more hazardous.
A horror comedy. But it's turned into a life and death situation.
It's the same dynamic, though. Desi is like, oh, come on, you're being crazy again. I mean, that's what they did every week on TV.
For sure. But the stakes are higher, I feel like. But what I was going to say was that she just plays this character with such psychopathic conviction.
And glee.
Yeah.
For the most part.
That she's too larger than life to just be annoying. So this is indescribably tense. This is worse than Cary Grant's drunk scene in North by Northwest.
Trailer very nearly goes into the abyss.
And what's so funny about it, I mean, I don't know how many people watching in 1954 would have had a trailer experience, because it's so much better if, like I was describing, you have had this middle class experience. Like, as an adult, I've never been middle class. I'm low income, low middle class. Worse than that, living in Toronto, I did have the full middle class experience growing up, particularly because my grandparents' generation who were still living like Lucy and Desi, right? I feel like it just has so much more impact, this whole sequence, if you've experienced something analogous to it.
He does finally learn the truth about the overloading of the trailer.
Some rocks come flying out, everything becomes dislodged as they're going down.
When he discovers that, I mean, he just throws everything out of the trailer. It's a complete bloodbath for her.
But for whatever reason, either because she realizes she's wrong, or because it's not gonna work, it just isn't what they thought it was going to be. And also she thinks her marriage is over. For whatever reason, she's going to get rid of this trailer now, which is in her name.
Yeah, that was his wedding present to her. He put it in her name. They have like a huge fight. He disappears and he goes off to sulk. And then, you know, we rejoin the framing story at the end. And they've been apart for 3 days. He's still boiling mad. He wants a final confrontation with his wife. It's not so clear that he wants her back at this point, as he vents with Maroney Olsen. And of course, it turns out, as we suspect, that this codger is there to buy Desi Arnaz's and Lucille Ball's very own trailer, the trailer we've gotten to know. So she's there. She's at this trailer park. Desi goes to have it out with her, but he does get some advice from the old man.
Right. He doesn't actually end up saying I'm sorry first, which is probably good because she really needs to.
Well, they say it together.
Definitely the rock prank was a bridge too far there.
It was pretty bad. Reconciliation at the end of the movie.
We don't know what's going to happen. They're just going to go on, but without the rocks? I don't know.
No, we don't know. I mean, they're going to get to Colorado and presumably have all kinds of other trials and tribulations, but they have made it through things that might have killed many others.
We're not even supposed to believe this ending. There is really no going on after this. It's just this is just a stopping point, a place to end the film. An arbitrary place, almost, other than the fact that it came after the climax.
Could be that they've been through their baptism of fire, and now they understand each other a little better, and they're going to communicate.
I see no future for this. I see no future for this trailer and this couple. You know? So, like, that's what I mean by it's just like an arbitrary cutting off happy ending.
Yeah, well, we'll never know. There's no sequel.
And now there'd be a sequel. Even Father of the Bride got a sequel.
Father's Little Dividend. Let's hear what Leonard Maltin had to say about The Cobweb. 2 stars from Maltin.
Wow.
Good cast in Static Soper, detailing the goings-on in psychiatric clinic headed by Dr. Widmark. Of course, some of the personnel are more unbalanced than the patients. Scripted by John Paxton, produced by John Houseman, film debuts of Strasberg and Kerr, director Vincente Minelli, of course, as all of these are, and the cast list is quite extensive. Richard Widmark, Lauren Bacall, Gloria Graham, Charles Boyer, Lillian Gish, John Kerr, Susan Strasberg, Oscar Levant, Tommy Rettig, Paul Stewart, Adele Juergens.
So I don't know if maybe Leonard Maltin hadn't got the memo back in 1990 that Minelli's melodramas were great works of art, great auteur works of art, masterpieces.
He's not with the program here. I disagree strongly with Maltin. I think this is an amazing movie.
Just the term static soper. First of all,
it's not static.
Well, and also using soap as a pejorative, but also it's not soapy.
No, not particularly.
It's just a melodrama. It's just a drama. It's an intricate cobweb of a drama. Now, of the 3 Minelli melodramas we watched, this is by far my least favorite.
Okay, sure, but if you're comparing it to Some Came Running and Home from the Hill, that's...
Which I am.
Those are titans. It's not as good as those, but I think it's great in its own right.
The problem with this one is that its themes are completely explicit, and all the characters say what they are by the end of the movie.
True enough.
There's no mystery. There's nothing to penetrate beyond.
Yeah, but that's where some of its power comes from.
Well, let's hear about it then, Dave. I loved Richard Widmark in a restrained performance.
Yeah, playing a caring liberal guy, which is basically what he was in real life.
Sure, and a professional.
The movie really comes together and stands or falls on the last line of The Sun. It's your job. It's so good. It really has an incredible impact. That kid is so good, The Sun. Just sitting there off to the side in all those scenes, eating cereal by himself in a breakfast nook. It's a genius stroke to have that at the end of the movie. It really brings everything together, and sure, it's explicit, but very potent, I think, evocation of the sense of mission that this character has.
Yes, but as everybody else says by the end of the movie, this sense of mission has come at the sacrifice of his family, and then that comes back and undermines his professional life.
It does, sure. Look, the fact that you care so much about your job can make you good at it, but can also be the reason that you are no longer good at it for a while if you get untracked in every other aspect of your life. It's looking mostly at life through a male lens and the kinds of ambitions that men have, the kinds of doubts that they have, and the kinds of blinkers that they might be wearing in their mission to succeed as the kind of men they want to be.
True, despite having this reputation as a melodramatist and being bi or gay or whatever people think Minelli is at this point, he's not a woman's director particularly.
No, he is called that, but I don't think that that's true. What he is a man very much on the outside of the sort of alpha male fraternity, looking at it in a way that, you know, someone like Howard Hawks can't do or won't let himself do. Minelli is able to do that, and most of his movies are about masculinity, which is something that is not always grasped by critics. Just because he's so sensitive, he can't be a director obsessed with men, but he certainly is.
Well, I think everybody has grasped that about Home from the Hill.
Well, that's where he's like, you know what? Fuck you all. This is about hunters and men, and you can't see anything else in this movie. He's on the same track through all of these movies. There are memorable, amazing female characters in movies that he directs, but they're not the central focus for the most part, even if they're the most likable characters often.
No, like as I said, even in the long, long trailer, you would expect Lucille Ball to be the main character, and she isn't.
No.
What's the problem with Richard Widmark's life here? Well, he has a trophy wife. He's made his own bed here that he's got to lie in, where he's rising in the ranks to the point where he is now in charge of this psychiatric whatever it is.
It's a care clinic with an endowment and a board and everything.
Sure. So,
yeah, he's been able to dictate his own terms. He has told them, if you want me to come there and give you the benefit of my skills, I have to have, you know, final cut, just like a really popular director.
So he's got all of the accoutrements again of a successful life of a man of his era, highly successful professional, and he's got the wife and the home and the kids, and the wife is for decoration. And now this is becoming a problem because she has no way of empathizing with his work and no way of fitting herself into that life, considering that, you know, it's just completely consuming him.
Yeah, I mean, she's got Betty Friedan problems here. She's looking for some way to make her life meaningful and having a very hard time, and he's not helping her in any way either.
No, he's totally unsympathetic to her.
Saving all of his sympathy for his patients.
Like, she should be a very annoying character. She should be the character that we dislike, but he is such a total ass to her, non-comprehending of the problems that he's creating for her, you end up sympathizing with her.
Oh yeah, I love Gloria Graham in this movie, and of course we are gonna watch it again in a few years, because Gloria Graham is our final auteurist oeuvre vue subject. After that we move on to spotlights of 6 movies at a time. We will be doing all of Gloria's films, and it'll be interesting to watch it again more exclusively through her perspective. But yeah, you can't talk about this movie without discussing the whole range of performances in it, and Gloria Graham does a wonderful job in a, you know, a role that could have been thankless. But Minelli's problem he sets for himself in this movie is to look at what is driving Widmark and what kinds of problems is he creating for himself. It does not give short shrift to Gloria Graham on her side of this divide. I mean, it really does spend some time with her.
Well, not to mention that she stops herself from having an affair and he goes ahead with his.
He sure does. does. Yeah. No, I mean, she is really distraught by the breakup of their marriage or the prospective loss of this marriage, and he's basically just written it off.
True, yeah.
And it's quite interesting that we start with her. Well, we start with John Kerr running through the cornfield, which is quite an amazing shot. She picks him up in the car, drives him back to this rest home or sanitarium, and they have a weird car conversation. And it turns out that, you know, that's where she was headed in the first place because she's married to Dr. Widmark. I like their dynamic in that car ride, too. She's very curious about this oddball who's spouting his philosophy of the torments of the artist.
Yeah, she's cultured. She's articulate.
She wants a lot from life, and she's getting none of it at this point.
Lauren Bacall has some pretty boring film roles in the 50s, and she's used by Douglas Sirk in a very boring way in Written on the Wind, but here she's very enjoyable, relaxed and natural in an interesting role.
Yeah, I think she's very good in this movie. I mean, she's able to project a sense of
authority, but also sadness.
Yeah, and stability.
But also fragility.
It really works. It's very good. Lauren Bacall, she's not a favorite actress of mine. I don't feel like she's got the kind of auteurist potential that many of her contemporaries had. But used in the right way, as Minelli does here, she can really bring a lot to a film.
For me, the best dramatic moment was when they're deciding to part after Stevie's gone missing.
They're dragging the lake.
When he just asks her, what am I supposed to do? And then her reply? Her reply is just in a devastating tone, right? Who do you think I am?
She's not there to give him all the answers.
She's just there to tell him, you know what? Adultery is not the thing we need right now.
No.
The cute conceit of the novel and the screenplay is that all of this drama centers around choosing drapes for the institution.
Yeah, so Gloria Graham decides this is the way. She is going to interface with Widmark's world, make some decorating suggestions, but there are other actors on the scene who have their own investment in making those decisions. Lillian Gish, the hyper-efficient administrator.
Well, she's more than hyper-efficient. She's terrifying. I love the scene between Lillian Gish and Richard Widmark because he's the only one who is, like, more assertive than she is out of the entire cast. He really brings some of that Widmark brutality in a restrained way, right? And just tells her what's what and wherefore.
Sure, he's a zealot. So is she. He can match her on that plane.
He does threaten to beat her as well.
He does. Well, yeah, all bets are off when you're a zealot. I mean, he believes he is fighting for the good of his patients, and she believes she is fighting for the good of the institution writ large. She doesn't seem to have much feeling for the patients, but it's her job to bring everything in under budget and please the board. But more important than any of that, she does have this powerful sense of vocation as well. You know, she is the one that has always run this place on the administrative side, and she's worked in tandem for many years with Charles Boyer, who was the kind of founder of this organization, but he's fallen on hard times. He's an alcoholic, philandering fool.
And right, and there's these upstarts, Richard Widmark and his wife, these interlopers have snuck in. What was Lauren Bacall's character's backstory? Her husband and child died?
Yeah, in an accident.
Yeah.
So she's looking to start her life over. Gish, she resents the interference of Gloria Graham, and of course, at first, you're sort of on her side, I think, in that sense, anyway.
Yeah, but except she's totally unreasonable.
Well, it's three different sides of this conflict, which is really fun.
See, that's why I think it's so ridiculous to call this a static soaper. It's kind of an intricately constructed drama or novel or whatever you want to call it, but it's more in the tradition of Middlemarch or something like that, right? Showing social complexity through the way that people are connected to each other in this microcosm.
It's also got a lot of kinship with 50s business dramas like Executive Suite and even Man in the Gray Flannel Suit a little bit. The sort of backstabbing and politics that go on when people are trying to assert themselves as the primary player in an institution or a business.
And Widmark seems like a Lydgate type, right?
Yeah.
He's a progressive. He wants to allow the patients to self-govern.
Yeah, well, how would you like to have Richard Widmark playing Lydgate and Gloria Graham playing Rosamund Vincy?
Yeah, sure, why not?
Lauren Bacall as Dorothea Brooke, maybe not. They need someone else for that role, I think. The greatest role of all time. Still never filmed by Hollywood. One day. But yeah, that's that's the kind of movie this is. And it certainly goes for the gusto. I don't think there's anything static about it. There's all kinds of stuff going on. As you say, if there is any flaw in it...
It's that there's nothing left underneath that. There's no mystery left underneath that.
Yeah, it wrings its subject dry by the end. But I'm not opposed to that kind of a thorough examination of something. It does have some mysterious elements to it. I mean, what is the rest of Lauren Bacall's life going to be like? We have no idea. She's going to drive off. Are the central Widmark and Gloria Graham couple going to really survive and be a stronger family unit after this?
Well, doesn't the ending have the words "and the trouble was over" written over it?
And what the movie does, and again, you could call this a little too pat, or you could just applaud it, but the idea at the end is that this, you know, the person whose actual life, whose existence has been most in jeopardy has been Stevie, the artist, and at the end of the movie, it's Widmark and Gloria Graham together who are kind of his parents, and tucking him in, and they're going to take care of him, and
finally allowing her to help him in his work. Basically.
Right, and so they're going to incorporate...
Well, that's what he says at the beginning of the movie, that they were like bad parents to him.
That's right.
That he saw her as the mother and Widmark as the father in the Oedipal complex. And then he has a speech to the staff about, might be specifically to Lauren Bacall, about how we have to be better parents, to model the possibility of better parents for these neurotics.
Yeah, and so there is a way, the movie does offer a way for Gloria Graham to take on that role and have an effect on the larger world outside of the domestic sphere, which is strangling her, and maybe that is going to work. Maybe she can be part of this therapeutic task that Widmark has undertaken, and they can both be fulfilled.
I found a Kirkus Reviews contemporary review of the novel, and from what I could make out, I don't know, having not read the novel, I don't know if I'm interpreting this correctly, but it did look like in the novel, the Widmark character does go off with Lauren Bacall character.
Really? I like this more.
You always like the Hollywood ending, the syrupy Hollywood ending more, Dave. Always.
Well, in a way, it's more syrupy to have him start a new life with this other woman that he's just met. I mean, it's more difficult, I think, to believably bring these two characters back together who've been at odds throughout the film. I mean, we've seen very few tender moments between them. I think that he does a pretty decent job of convincing you that there's a chance here.
Well, I think it's because we do have the sympathy for the Gloria Graham character throughout because she's such a blind spot.
Yeah.
To Widmark. And I mean, it works really well to have Lauren McCall's character make the decision, like just completely make the decision that this is going to end, because that forces him to confront the marriage, right? It's not like he's made the choice to sacrifice this new love.
No, that wouldn't have worked, I don't think. He's got to come back to it. And of course, when they part, Stevie is still presumed dead. I mean, it's a pretty dark moment in the film. And when he staggers home from all of that, that's where he finds Stevie in the garage, all disheveled. I came back. It's really good. I really like it.
So rather than a soaper, I feel like this movie is maybe a little too serious.
For Malton?
No, a little too serious for me. A little too much of a kind of serious Oscar movie about issues.
Okay.
That's, like I said, is kind of lacking in some of that psychological mystery. But let's get on to the two best movies that we watched for this episode, because we need to save some time for them.
Some Came Running, one of the greatest movies ever made, undoubtedly.
Yeah, but I was wondering if I didn't like Home from the Hill a little better.
They're both pretty great. You can make an argument for either, most likely.
So Some Came Running, like From Here to Eternity, was based on a novel by James Jones. From Here to Eternity, I believe, was his first novel?
I think so. I've only read the two, but I've always wanted to read the rest because I love both of those books.
Yeah, it was his debut novel, and it was very critically acclaimed. Some Came Running was apparently trash, but it was a bestseller, and the movie was critically acclaimed.
Yeah, well, let me tell you about Some Came Running. I've always loved the movie, or I have loved it ever since I first saw it. As I often do, I will track down the novels that were the bases for these films. Some Came Running was a real problem because the original novel, which is what I wanted to read, was just immense. Just 1,000 pages long or more, maybe more than that, I forget exactly, but it went out of print immediately. The movie came out and it was replaced by an expurgated version or a condensed version, and that's all that was available. And when I was living in Vancouver, I found, you know, the first edition at the library, and I took it out of the library and read the novel. That was the first time I read it, the whole thing, the version that nobody else had ever read. Now, I think just recently, some publisher has released all of the full director's cut versions of James Jones novels. So I'm kind of interested in looking at those. But it is a crazy book. Just so much going on in it. Very different from the movie, too. I mean, they're not at all the same. The Shirley MacLaine character, movie version of her, has nothing to do with the character in the book, who is kind of a monster, although she's certainly not the only one.
I guess looking at this again, can't find anything that says that the novel sold well. But yeah, it was absolutely torn apart by the critics.
Yeah, it's an incredibly crazy, self-indulgent novel. It's like a Melville novel, the original text.
Here are some of the quotations from reviews. A fictional disaster, clumsily written, crudely repetitious, ineptly convincing in many scenes, cheaply vulgar throughout. Some came running is also so gamey and rancid in its concentration on sex that it seems like the work of an adolescent obsessed by the Kinsey reports. Another one here. 1,266 pages of flawlessly sustained tedium.
There you go.
A very bad book indeed. Self-conscious, discursive, ineptly plotted and clumsily written. The reader is battered into helpless insensibility by Jones's analyses, explanations, theories, and opinions. That does sound very Melvillian.
That's the kind of book I love. Absolutely must be on everyone's reading list. Go to the library in Vancouver and read it. Let's hear what Leonard Maltin had to say about the film. He gives it 3 stars out of 4.
Well, that's not right.
Nope.
He really didn't get the memo. Someone needs to go in a time machine and mail him the memo back to 1990.
Slick adaptation of James Jones's novel about disillusionment in a small Midwestern town in the late 1940s. More character study than narrative. MacLaine is especially good as luckless floozy who's stuck on Sinatra. Elmer Bernstein's music score, also a standout.
That doesn't say a lot.
Maltin's cast list: Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Shirley MacLaine, Martha Heyer, Arthur Kennedy, Nancy Gates. So this is a pretty overwhelming movie. Did you see it for the first time with me?
Yeah, I hadn't thought a lot about Vincente Minnelli as a director before. Before you, Dave?
Really?
No.
So again, here we are certainly dealing with the demons of masculinity.
Yeah, there's a lot of overlap between this and Home from the Hill, and they were made kind of back to back almost. Some Came Running and came out in 1958, and Home from the Hill in 1960.
So we've got the origins of the Rat Pack here. A little bit.
I guess, yeah.
The core figures, Dean Martin and Frank Sinatra, together making an amazing duo, I think. Could argue that this is the best performance either one of them ever gave, although Sinatra gave a lot of great performances, in fact, and Dean Martin gave more than people might suspect.
Well, you really love him in Rio Bravo.
I certainly do.
He's really great being a sleazebag in Kiss Me Stupid.
Yeah, no, I mean, there's a lot to choose from in both of these guys' careers in terms of performances. They did certainly start to phone it in at some point, but they're not doing that here. I mean, this is intense and risky in a way. I mean, both of them are playing pretty sleazy individuals here.
Yeah, Dean Martin really didn't care about that.
Absolutely didn't care.
You know who he kept reminding me of in this movie? Like a slightly updated version of Robert Mitchum's character in Till the End of Time.
Okay, a little bit, sure. Bama?
Yeah.
In the novel, he has a whole family, which is excised from his backstory here. He's got a wife and all kinds of kids. Yeah, he only goes to see occasionally.
That zombie girl?
Yeah.
That he hangs out with, the zombie prostitute, who kept reminding me of Candy from Twin Peaks The Return. She's so zoned out. This is an actress who, I've only seen her in big movies and minor roles, but she is so memorable. She is so distinctive on the screen that I have never forgotten. I'm pretty sure she's you said she's in Marnie?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I'm pretty sure she's that secretary who has that line, that very distinctive line delivery. No, Mr. Strutt. Don't you remember? She didn't have any references. No references at all. I mean, I can't do it, but she's great.
Yeah, she's very good.
She really brings a little something to these minor roles.
Shirley MacLaine's co-worker down at the brassiere factory, and they go out on their double dates to whatever dive in Parkman or in Terre Haute that they want to go to.
I mean, what interests me in it is obviously the contrast between the two women. The sexual I always love a movie from this period. The 50s and 60s melodramas are the greatest moment for exploring sexual mores in American cinema, and this movie is an example of that. The screenplay, does this have anything to do with the novel at all? These contrasting women?
Oh, yeah, of course. Of course. It's just that the novel really doesn't have anything good to say about anyone. I mean, it does not turn the Shirley MacLaine character into a saint.
So obviously what the movie has done then is to make sympathetic characters out of all of these people.
Yeah.
Particularly out of the Frank Sinatra and Shirley MacLaine characters, though. And yeah, and the Shirley MacLaine character ends up being a saint in much the same fashion. It's interesting, I wasn't even thinking about this watching the movies, but you mentioned Father of the Bride in relation to the Long Long trailer, and then it's possible to see a lot of connections between Some Came Running and Home from the Hill. So the Shirley MacLaine character becomes a saint with the veneer of sexual sin to give her pathos and to give her abjection, right? In just the same way that Raphael does in Home from the Hill.
Yeah.
And did you know, Dave, do you know anything about the Home from the Hill novel?
No.
Well, Rafe isn't in it.
Wow.
Yeah, completely invented for the movie. Yeah, this seems definitely like an auteur touch for Minelli to formulate the stories around these characters and what they bring to this study in both cases of sexual mores.
Oh yeah. I highly recommend the novel, but again, it has nothing to do with this movie. I mean, it's set in a town called Parkman. It's got some characters with the same names, but Minelli has done his own thing with Some Came Running, and it is wonderful.
So we have a frigid woman, one of the favorite female figures of these movies.
Yeah, Martha Heyer, a Hitchcock blonde.
From the 50s and 60s. More of a Grace Kelly type than a Tippi Hedren. And we have a sex worker, basically. Shirley MacLaine's character. Although she also gets other jobs.
Yeah, like at the brassiere factory.
She's not making a living off of her sex work.
Well, I think she was in Chicago, right? She's basically...
She's cleaning herself up for Frank.
I don't even know if it's that. It's just that's the only job available. Because she was working at a club in Chicago. There aren't really any sex clubs in Parkman.
Before the code completely runs out, you can't just have a straight-up prostitute. This is also the case for From Here to Eternity. Who works in a brothel, you have to have a woman who works in a club. So it's a kind of a euphemism. So Frank Sinatra's character is torn between them in a way that sort of resembles the Clark Gable triangle in Red Dust. Other than the fact that he never does have... There's never really any kind of rapport between him and Shirley MacLaine. It's just her being infatuated with him.
Yeah.
There's no, I mean, at the end of the movie makes very clear there is no potential future for them as a couple, as much as he would like there to be. There isn't. He just does not love her, because he is the most fucked up person in the movie sexually of all.
Yeah, well, and his character does have a lot to do with the James Jones novel character. I mean, of course it's all about him. It's basically James Jones's version of Melville's Pierre, and of course that can't be anything but a good thing.
Do you think that's on purpose? Because actually that it does fit with the two women.
Of course it does. Very much that.
Did he really try to write a horrifying mess of a failure of a second novel based on Melville's Pierre? Or was it just brilliant American author coincidence?
Yeah, I think it's more that, but I don't know anything about James Jones as a person. I don't think he was a well-adjusted, happy guy.
Neither was Melville.
Well, exactly. So they have that in common. He also showed a similar disregard for his literary reputation. But beyond that, you know, he's a subject for further study. Definitely someone I want to know more about.
Well, he made a war trilogy out of From Here to Eternity, and the second novel in the trilogy, A Thin Red Line, that was later made into a Malick movie. So for me, this is the interest, this triangle, and what it has to say about the sexual psychology of, well, only really Frank Sinatra's character and Martha Heyer's. Because Shirley MacLaine is simple. She's just a lower-class girl who, as we talked about, because, you know, this is the screenplay. I don't know what the novel's about, but the screenplay is in the tradition of great American epics like King's Row. And we were talking about its study of sexual mores, which is along the same lines, despite being a decade earlier. What year is King's Row?
1942.
So basically almost two decades earlier. So Shirley MacLaine's character, yes, is a lower class girl who therefore has sexual freedom, but is also looked down on for that.
Well, very much so. Even by the men who spend most of their time in the gutters, especially by the men who spend most of their time in the gutters.
She's a pig, a word that comes up again in Home from the Hill. So this is a, I don't know if this is actually a common euphemism for horror or if Minelli invented it. I have no idea.
It's absolutely brutal when Dean Martin says that word.
Repeatedly.
It just sounds like it's got to be censored immediately. It's so harsh.
Yeah, it's worse than calling her a whore.
Horrifying.
How do you see it? Do you see this the same way that I do?
Well, of course, it's a gigantic examination of the Madonna whore complex.
Well, no, not just that.
But that's a big part of it.
Conflict in Martha Heyer's character is the most visible, so maybe that's a good place to start examining mm-hmm. this movie's exploration of that topic.
And I think she does a terrific job in this role. She was nominated for an Oscar, right? Did she win?
She was nominated for Best Supporting Actress.
So she's an intellectual. She's a critic and teacher of literature at the college nearby. She loves Dave's work, Frank Sinatra's character. He's from Parkman, but he's been a drifter working on oil rigs, doing all kinds of odd jobs, finally wound up in the army during World War II. Of course, that's when we meet him as he returns from overseas. She's been following his life through, you know, the stories he would write for magazines, the millions of magazines at the time. And he has written two novels, which have netted him about $24 or something, he says. Sort of like Macaulay Connor in the Philadelphia story.
48.
They're in libraries, but that's about it. I mean, he's gotten paid for some of the stories that were published in magazines, but for the most part, he's been living on these very roughneck jobs and getting paid as a soldier and maybe winning the occasional huge pot in a big gambling session. And he's quite flush at the beginning of this film. He's got $5,000 in a cashier's check.
He hates his respectable brother.
The way the movie starts is really important. You know, we've got the incredibly intense music playing over the trajectory of a bus into a small Midwestern American town, the Greyhound. Sinatra is passed out and he's awakened by the bus driver who tells him that it's Parkman. They told me to wake you when we got to Parkman. Not you told me to wake you. It was not his idea to come here. He got into some kind of problem in Chicago and was too drunk to make his own decisions and was thrown on this bus by friends or foes. We don't really know.
It's like that Fox musical we just watched.
Yeah.
With John Payne's character bringing along, which one was that?
Carmen Miranda.
Carmen Miranda and Edward Everett Horton. Yeah. While he was drunk, while he was on a bender.
Springtime in the Rockies.
Right.
Things that you don't necessarily expect or want will happen when you get that drunk. So an important public service announcement. In this case, Sinatra has someone who's come along for the ride.
Well, he asked her along, just like Carmen Miranda.
Now she's got just as much enthusiasm for the whole thing, even more so than Carmen Miranda has. She just couldn't believe how sweet he was when he asked her to come meet his family in Parkman. So I guess it was his idea, to some extent.
We never see him act that sweet. We see him get a little less mean to her when he's drunk, but we never see him act as sweet as she seems to think he acts.
Yeah, well, what we also see is that he gets sort of sarcastically nice with her sometimes when he's drunk, too, when she's misinterpreting.
Yeah, she's too naive to understand the sarcasm.
She just takes it for granted that people say what they mean. But of course, you can't do that with complicated beings like Frank Sinatra's character.
So the reason I don't call it a straightforward Madonna horror complex is, first of all, he's obviously, and this is why also why I related to the Clark Gable character in Red Dust, he's attracted to Gwen, Martha Heyer's character, on the basis of class, and he's repelled from Shirley MacLaine to a large extent on that basis as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, Gwen's character reminded me a lot of, I wondered if James Jones, or the screenwriters, who knows, read this, were familiar with this text, but it reminded me a lot of the story of Dora.
Oh, we've talked about Dora before on this podcast.
Yeah. Yeah, Freud's Dora, Freud's case history. Particularly, it's been a long time since I read Dora, but I seem to recall that for Freud, in his wild interpretation of Dora's sexual problems, that he thought that the basis of the neurosis was that this man that she was inappropriately in love with had made a pass at a lower class woman before he made a pass at her. And so she was angered to be, you know, put in that same company.
Besmirched.
And this is clearly what's causing the neurotic behavior behavior of Gwen throughout this movie.
And she's aware of it, very hyper aware of it, because she's a critic.
She even says at one point, intellectually, yeah, I understand your lifestyle and maybe even find it appealing, but emotionally I'm a very commonplace person.
It's a very interesting performance, right? Because she does register on all those levels. She is a devotee of his writing, which is all about being crass and down and out and fucked up in various locales around the world. It excites her to read about this stuff, but at the end of the day, does she want to spend a lot of time with these actual characters in her beautiful kitchen?
It's not just that, though. Yeah, true. But also, she is deeply conventional. She has, to the bone, she has absorbed these mores, and her intellectual development doesn't help her shake them off in any way.
No, and that's part of the achievement of the movie, to give us all of that, to show us a woman grappling with these, you know, conflicting emotions. She can't be, you know, delighted to just go to the country club every weekend either and sit around with those dolts. But on the other hand, it seems to be all that she can handle at her table.
But she is very, very neurotic. Like, she seems to be heading down the road to spinsterhood here. She doesn't seem to be able to handle any kind of sexual relationship.
Well, not so far. And her dad is pretty eager to get her out there. He's seen the signs. He's concerned. He's very indulgent of Dave. He's a very sensitive man, he says. He's certainly a man given to fits of passion anyway. We don't see a lot of fathers in movies of this vintage eager to have their daughter date a character like Frank Sinatra. This professor certainly is, or he says he is anyway.
Well, sure, anything that could unthaw her.
So they're a very interesting pair, father and daughter, living off in their upper middle class life. They're a patrician, you know, they didn't have to scramble for all of this. They've owned huge swaths of the territory around Parkman for ages. They're the very best class of people. On the other hand, you've got Dave's brother Frank, played by Arthur Kennedy, the great Arthur Kennedy.
Sorry, that just reminded me of a great moment I'd forgotten in The Cobweb, when Lillian Gish thunders to Richard Widmark's character that her grandfather or whoever fought the Indians.
Oh yeah.
Fought the Indians to achieve this grand home of hers, right?
Yeah, and Richard Widmark,
he gets kind of a contemptuous little grunt.
In a slightly more contemporary movie, would have made the jerk-off motion. And she said that, and rightly so. It's always nice to have a movie not be reverent of the pioneers who committed genocide.
Right. Obviously, that's going to be that kind of theme. I don't know how much Minnelli has talked about for liberalism in his movies, but...
Oh, yeah, it's definitely there.
But in Home from the Hill, it's much more developed.
Some Came Running, it is more of a character study than a narrative, as Maldon points out. So there's not a huge sequence of events, but there are indelible characters brought into close proximity with one another, and you're just waiting to see what's going to happen.
I'm pretty engrossed the whole time.
Me too. Me too.
So ultimately, he does end up having a tryst with Gwen. We're shown that she is very sexually passionate. She's not actually technically frigid.
No.
She just is very conflicted about... I don't know what she's very conflicted about.
Well, she's afraid of Frank Sinatra's outburst, which is not unreasonable. He's a drunken, violent character.
That's what you think. I think everything for her is focused around this Shirley MacLaine character and her knowledge of his association with her.
Well, I think it can be things at once.
Yeah, exactly. But that, for her, is just objective correlative of his nature. She doesn't seem to have wanted to marry anyone before him, and once she meets him, she's terribly conflicted about marrying him for that reason, and also because she's very conventional, as she says, she also doesn't want to continue to have a sexual relationship out of wedlock.
No, it wouldn't be very fun for her.
But she's not technically frigid. She's very passionate.
Let's also not forget, Frank Sinatra doesn't want to continue to have a passionate relationship with her out of wedlock. He wants to marry her. He's obsessed with her.
Well, that's what I'm saying, but yeah. She, in this Dora-like way, she can't bring herself to marry him, knowing... Well, what's interesting is that Shirley MacLaine's abject sexuality, like sexuality as objection, transfers itself onto him, and he becomes besmirched with it, and he himself becomes abject in Gwen's eyes. And to associate with him, the contamination would spread to her as well.
Yeah, and it's necessary, right? Because Sinatra on screen in this movie doesn't really do much except lust after Martha Heyer and push Shirley MacLaine away. We don't see him being promiscuous, really.
Right.
He just is sitting in rooms with lots of drunken, promiscuous people, but all he wants to do is marry teacher.
Yeah, but I mean, we do understand that he slept with Shirley MacLaine.
Well, he slept with her when he's drunk. He doesn't remember it. It's not really part of the life that he consciously lives. It's just something he slips into as an afterthought when he's too drunk to manipulate his body. It's very clear he doesn't remember anything about it. He's not getting anything out of it. You know, when he realizes who she is and why she's there, he's very apologetic, never leering with her. He just wants her to go away.
That's what's interesting too, and again, why it's not a exact virgin whore complex, because he's not particularly interested in Shirley MacLaine except that she's there, she's available for sex. But Gwen is the one that he lusts after.
The thing that Shirley MacLaine does have that makes it a triangle is, you know, the intense emotion she has for him.
Yeah.
He is struck by that, and it does start to affect his calculations at a certain
point. Well, because Gwen is acting in an incomprehensible way.
Yeah, and no matter what, Gwen is never going to be as devoted to him as Shirley MacLaine's character. It's impossible. Because she's got too many other things she's focused on.
But even that doesn't matter. She does love him. She doesn't want to.
No.
She doesn't want to, and she doesn't want to do anything about it.
She also wouldn't throw herself in front of a bullet for him, no matter how much she loves him, probably.
True. But I think he would take her more moderate love if she'd be willing to give it to him.
Yeah,
but she's not.
Probably.
And the reason she's not is because this association with Shirley MacLaine and all it means, and the fact that it means that he's a male whore who's not good enough for her, keeps rearing its head.
The confrontation in the schoolroom between Shirley MacLaine and Martha Heyer, what an amazing scene.
Well, it's amazingly framed because before that we hear her answering the student's questions about...
You can't judge great men.
The immoral behavior of great men, and she talks about some of the sleaziest literary men in history, culminating in Baudelaire, who really was quite a number. He associated with prostitutes and what have you.
No doubt. But again, those are dead artists.
So, yeah, and she does defend them. But then as soon as she's faced with Shirley MacLaine, she has an absolute failure of empathy. And everything that she's just said about how she would try to understand these men, right? It just completely goes out the window when she's faced with the reality of it. And she reverts back to her wholly conventional self.
The intensity of MacLaine's emotions just startle her. They startle Sinatra. They startle everyone. And they startle the viewer. It's an incredible performance. By Shirley MacLaine. You cannot watch that scene and not be deeply affected.
I don't know what it was about Shirley MacLaine that she kept getting cast as gammon fallen women. You know, very much in the vein of Ladies of the Bois de Boulogne, that character.
Well, they're good meaty parts. I think she
I know, but
liked
there,
playing
something,
those
there
roles.
There was something so unconventional about her as a figure that she kept getting slotted into these parts and brought something to them. Like, nobody just wanted her to play a normal romantic lead, apparently.
No, she's got too much to offer to waste her time with that.
She's in no way obviously sexual, and that's what she brings to these parts, the fact that she's not obviously sexual, that there's something completely off-kilter about her personality, right? And about her self-presentation. She has pathos. She has a lot of pathos, and she has, yeah, this gammon quality that's very innocent. And she's got a great body, as
she sure
Sinatra
does.
Comments in the movie. But sex is not the first thing you would associate with her.
Powerful emotions and all of the other oddities that she brings. And meanwhile, you've got the masculine code between the two bros, the gambling bros, as they go on their adventures.
Well, okay, so when, after this confrontation with Shirley MacLaine, where MacLaine is trying to figure out, is there going to be any possible wedding here? And by appearing, she doesn't realize that she is destroying any possibility of a marriage. It's not her intention. But yeah, that's just the end once Gwen has actually laid eyes on her.
Yeah, she's read the newspaper stories about the bar fights over floozies and stuff like that. But now to see it, that's enough.
And Gwen just shrivels and dies as a character before our eyes in that scene, right? Even as MacLaine's character, Ginny, blossoms.
Yeah.
All of the sympathy that I previously had for Gwen just shrivels and dies. She fails. She has presented herself as a certain type of person to her class, and she has failed by her own standards. Utterly failed.
Yeah, which is a really interesting dichotomy there, because it would have been more typical to have a woman, you know, being constrained by the image she's trying to project to the world versus emotions. Here, the image she has created is as a kind of cosmopolitan woman of the world, and her emotional life, as we've said already, is so constrained. Nobody cares cares what she does except her. Nobody's saying, oh no, don't get married to this Dave. Everyone around her is actually pushing her toward him, no matter what he does, no matter how many times he gets arrested.
Yeah, it's interesting. Where has she absorbed these ideas about who she should be?
It's right? That goddamn country club. But yeah, this is sort of a Foucauldian presentation of a woman trapped in a patriarchal structure, basically, right?
Right. So there's no specific man telling her what she can or can't do, but no. Somehow she still understands what the rules of the society are.
She's done it to herself.
No, but it's the kind of the narcissistic standards to which she holds herself. It's not that, well, the country club would disapprove, but it's not who would disapprove of her. It's some way in which she views herself.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. So she's her own jailer.
Yeah.
Which is not typical.
And that is a very, I don't know if it's Hitchcockian. It reminds me of something like the Philadelphia story, maybe.
Well, maybe, sure. I mean, Tracy Lord is surrounded by a family that has, we're told anyway, they are more liberal-minded and more tolerant of frailty.
Well, certainly her ex-husband wants her to be wilder, to express a wilder side to herself.
So does her dad. Yeah, so there's something of that. We do have to spend some time with the relationship between Sinatra and Dean Martin. And Dean Martin's performance in this movie, I don't think I'm wrong here. It was Godard's favorite film performance of all time. Dean Martin, The Man in the Hat.
I don't know. He really loved this movie anyway.
And he has, you know, the tribute in Le Mépris, I think. The character in the bath with the hat on.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, his gesture at the end of this film is incredibly meaningful. I mean, he manages to make a man taking his hat off to a dead woman a very powerful experience. For me, anyway. I don't know how you feel about it. You only get there because of the unadulterated contempt he shows for all women, and especially for Shirley MacLaine throughout the movie. I mean, he's just disgusting.
Sure, but what happens here is, after Sinatra realizes he's never going to be able to marry Gwen because she acts crazy again, he comes home to Ginny. She tells him about how much she loves him again. He makes a, in one sense, very rational decision to hook himself to her. Why not? It makes sense. Why not stop chasing somebody who refuses to love you and marry somebody who really loves you.
I do think it helps that they have that sparring match, for lack of a better word.
Oh yeah, as much as she's capable of, she stands up to him.
That's a very important scene.
Well, no, doesn't he propose to her after he reads her the story?
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. He reads her the story, she talks about the things that she figures he wants to hear about what she liked about it, but it also seems to be coming from the heart, even though she can't explain it. And he's like, you're stupid, you don't understand my story at all. And she's like, no, I don't understand. I mean, that outburst.
I can like it even though I don't understand it. That's what she said.
Yeah, and she compares it to him. I don't understand you at all, but I love you.
And the way Shirley MacLaine plays it, do you believe that she does like the story?
Yes, yes. I think you have to believe that. She is fascinated by this guy and by the art that he creates as well. She's just really interested in all of it, and all of it is baffling to her and discombobulating but exciting. And it's something new for her.
And I don't know, that seems to somehow get through to him.
It does.
Well, I mean, he has had no success with a woman who completely intellectually understands him but doesn't get him at all, right? So this is kind of like the inverse of that, right?
Exactly.
So he makes this decision that seems to be a healthy thing for him to do, for both of them. But you can also understand Dean Martin's perspective, not the reason he gives for why they shouldn't get married, but that this is a completely crazy thing to do.
Man, you really blew your top.
Because he doesn't love her, and because she is a pushover, as Dean Martin says.
And in the novel, it's even more pointed because Bama does have this, you know, sick life of his own, right? Where he's got this whole family and he plays the dad like one day a week, and then he's off whoring and gambling 6 days a week, and he's like, that's how a man lives. You know, you keep your family off to the side, that's who you marry, and then you do all this other crazy stuff.
Well, here it comes out of left field because you're not necessarily expecting him to take this attitude.
No, exactly. But he does sell it. It's like, no, look, we're having a lot of fun driving to Terre Haute, gambling, getting into fights. You know, maybe people are going to shoot us one day because we're so good at gambling.
Oh, yeah, he does. He also says, why should you bother marrying her? Like, you're living together anyway.
Yeah.
We don't need to do this.
Just because it'll make her happy? Fuck you. But what he doesn't understand is that Frank Sinatra wants to marry anyone.
And he, well, not anyone, not at all anyone. The point is that he wants to be happy himself.
He wants someone to love him.
Yes.
You know, Bama doesn't care about that kind of thing.
I guess not. Well, he's on a path to suicide, basically.
Yeah, he's diabetes.
He's diabetic and he's drinking himself to death.
No, he's very content. I mean, we've seen lots of characters like this. Like, this is my style of living. I'm going out this way, not taking any doctor's advice.
I frankly do not know how an untreated diabetic who's drinking like he does is walking and speaking, but...
Well, clearly it's not going to last much longer.
But he does have that nice scene with the nun in the hospital.
I mean, he's very affable.
She talks about his hat superstition and she's beating him at cards.
It's a great performance by Dean Martin because he does seem like a fun friend. But on the other hand, he is voicing the most appalling opinions you've ever heard.
Well, his opinions, though, are the same as Gwen's.
Yeah, basically, he's a mirror image of her.
Yeah.
And of course, they are the people that the film focuses on at the end. At the funeral, Gwen standing there trying to make sense of all of this, and Dean Martin taking off his hat after Ginny has sacrificed her life.
Well, yeah, the movie gives you some kind of
catharsis.
Or some kind of idea, even, which seems like tacked on hopefulness.
Yeah, that's not in the novel.
No, but some idea that maybe Gwen could actually, now that Shirley MacLaine is dead, she could have some kind of empathy for her, which does sound in keeping with Gwen.
That's how she likes things. Not, difficult things should be dead.
Not living and speaking to her and actually associating with people that she associates with, but safely dead.
Yeah.
And then she can appreciate what a sacrifice this woman made, what a saint she really was. For me, though, the most moving moment is the pillow.
Oh, yeah.
Because you can see in front of your eyes, you watch, and this is a testament to Frank Sinatra's performance. In front of your eyes, you see him appreciate her as she dies. Start to appreciate her as she dies. Which is a trope, but you don't usually actually see it unfold in real time on the screen.
Always happens just a little too late. Now, we could talk for hours about visual splendor of the film as well. Pretty much across the board for all of these movies.
The carnival movie sequence, but just the... which is very noirish as well. For me, the brilliance of that sequence is watching Sinatra, and maybe the most noirish part of it too, is watching Sinatra and Shirley MacLaine walking through the carnival and feeling his utter despair and desperation because he wants so much to be happy and he's never going to be able to be happy. He cannot love back someone who loves him. It's just not possible.
No, that's right.
And we all have trouble with that, don't we? A little bit, humans?
Certainly, and the movie does go into that to some extent, right? I mean, the parental figure to him is Frank, his older brother, who sent him away to be raised by other people. As he began to, you know, do his social climbing, he marries the daughter of a prominent businessman, and now he's a prominent businessman because of it. So there's a lot of that kind of social analysis going on in the film, too. And it's so many different movies at once. Arthur Kennedy is giving, you know, a champion kind of Babbitt performance of a stultified, you know, pillar of the community. And I mean, he's such a great actor that he makes you feel for him as well, even though you also hate him with Dave a lot of the time. He's a hypocrite. But his emotional life is explored to some extent, and the feelings that he has for his secretary aren't completely tawdry. I mean, he does have a terrible marriage, and he does respect his secretary to some extent, right?
I actually completely forgot that entire plot, even though, yeah, it is very good in the movie. And then the daughter recognizing that he's a hypocrite and deciding, why am I holding myself to some kind of standard of virginal perfection if the people who are telling me to do that are, you know, it's a very, very Peyton Place. That's where Peyton Place starts.
Yeah.
Right? The TV show.
If feminine rebellion is just getting drunk and having sex with fat salesmen, that doesn't sound all that exciting.
Well, no, because then Frank Sinatra decides to straighten her out.
Yeah.
Right? And so then here are some more of those double standards being reinforced. This is, you know, men can associate with whoever they want, but a girl is going to have her beautiful innocence ruined by it.
Well, yeah, but let's not forget that Sinatra does feel ruined by his life. He does feel...
Well, this is the question. This is where you'd have to get really start probing what is the movie's attitude towards sex, because to what extent is this kind of lifestyle, I mean, we talk about this a lot when we look at David Lynch films, Far Walk With Me and whatnot, to what extent is this kind of promiscuous lifestyle actually corrupting to the people who engage in it, and to what extent is that just a bogeyman?
I would say, I feel like Minnelli's enlightened enough to show us that it's not corrupting in any kind of absolute moral sense. But he also understands the psychology of the 20th century man and woman enough to know that self-hatred does creep in when they embark on sexual escapades that they have misgivings about and don't fully enjoy while it's happening.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because I was going to say, obviously, if you can keep some kind of feeling alive, like Shirley MacLaine's character, then it doesn't matter what you're doing sexually.
Yeah, there's no corruption there.
She's not judged in any way.
No, because she actually, and she is choosy, you know? She chose Frank Sinatra. She doesn't like this Raymond guy.
Well, that's the tragic mechanism of the movie, right? The fact that she doesn't want to sleep with Raymond.
No. Yeah, there's so much going on in this movie. Maybe we'll revisit it. Maybe I will get it on the schedule again and get Elise to read the novel along with
it. Oh, God. I don't know if that's ever going to happen.
You're going to love it.
Too much to read.
Well, in the 2030s, you know, we may have some more time in our golden years.
Doubtful.
Let's move on to Home from the Hill.
They say to each other that her way of raising him has been as much responsible for this genius that he manifests. Well, actually, it's solely responsible for it, because Mitchum doesn't have to do basically anything other than say, okay, it's time for you to be a man. And he's all prepared to do it. But she has raised him to have a mind of his own, as she says, and this introverted life that he's led has somehow, he's made him some kind of perfectionist, given him some kind of single-mindedness.
Well, yeah, once he gets the go-ahead to start killing things, he just doesn't stop. They make it like one of those public service announcements about letting your house cat out and how many birds they kill in a year. He's just running roughshod. He's doing more damage on the countryside than that wild boar, for sure. He's skipping school every day to kill things in the woods.
And of course, the sequence of killing the wild boar, even though we're not sympathetic to that here. I mean, who is going to be sympathetic to killing a wild boar watching a movie? Not many people, like a few wild boar hunters maybe. It's nevertheless absolutely thrilling.
Yeah, and George Hamilton.
And terrifying too.
I mean, he's
a superhero.
He's afraid, but he's also very scary. And
yes, yeah.
I mean, Minnelli,
he's scarier than the boar.
Well, he makes it very clear. There's all these gentle woodland creatures getting out of his way as he tracks down the boar.
It really is the staging of the confrontation between man and nature.
And it's this little weedy guy, George Hamilton. You know, he's giving a great performance too, and it's a really weird role, right? Because he seems to be the protagonist, but ultimately he is not, right? I mean, it's really much more about Rafe, George Peppard, but, you know, you couldn't have this movie, you couldn't have all the themes explored fully without everything that goes on with George Hamilton.
Well, but yeah, because he is the one who, just as he has the courage to face the boar, he is the one who decides to stand up against his father for progressive values.
He's not angry at his father for whoring around. He's angry at him for not acknowledging his son.
Yeah, exactly.
And keeping him around the place on a shack.
And not equally sharing their inheritance.
Yeah, there's really...
He really is a remarkable kid.
Yeah, he is. I mean, he's willing to give up everything to stand by that judgment that he renders upon his father. I mean, he leaves behind all the money that is his legally, gets this horrible job at a cotton baling factory.
Right, and this is where we get some of those underlying thematics that I was talking about. I did find a essay on the Blu-ray release by Cineast magazine, a review essay. It calls attention to the association of both sons with black people in the town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of subtle commentary going on about the racialized social structure in the town.
Yeah, because all of his workmates are black people.
Yeah.
And they are working on the cotton, just like they always have done, even though now it's industrialized.
Reconstruction fell apart, and nothing basically changed in the way social structure was organized, despite the elimination of slavery. It just continued by other means.
And George Peppard has a speech in that same dog washing scene where he talks about he associates himself with black people in the community as an illegitimate orphaned boy.
Yeah, well, that's the advice he was given. happen. Look, if you got no one in your corner the way everyone who's black in that town would feel and would be, then you're just gonna have to make do and try to live as best you can without any kind of expectations. And that is certainly how George Peppard has lived his life.
I actually like the feverish melodrama scene where Eleanor Parker reveals the backstory to George Hamilton. It reminded me of some of the insane melodrama sequences about the illegitimate family in Daniel Deronda. Just the shift of tone to madness around this theme of illegitimacy. This woman was mewling. She was making horrible mewling noises. Or meowing, or whatever the hell she says. It's crazy.
It is. It's a good performance by Eleanor Parker because she can express these ideas, which are obviously anathema to a sensitive modern viewer, but without wholly losing the sympathy of the audience.
Well, I mean, she's like, I don't know, some kind of Southern patrician version of the Gwen character.
Exactly.
Right? She is so horrified that her husband produced a child out of wedlock that she hasn't had sex with him since her first child was born.
Yeah.
And this is what has brought him to the pass of sleeping with whores in the town and other men's wives, and is ultimately going to be his downfall.
Yeah, it's one of the first things that we see in the film. He gets shot by a local man over this tryst he had with the man's wife, and Mitchum confides to Rafe that he doesn't remember who this woman might have been that he was supposed to have slept with. He's not getting anything out of these experiences either. I mean, he's on autopilot.
Yeah, it's just sexual release. That's all it is. That's what George Hamilton says, isn't it? To make Mitchum make that gesture that you were talking about when he says she must have been some pig to sleep with you, or however he puts it. Now, we were talking about the contagion, the way in which Gwen sees Shirley MacLaine's character as contaminated Frank Sinatra and turning him, making him abject too, even though he's a man. And something similar happens here. There's also sexual contagion, but in this case it's from a daughter to her father.
Yeah.
The shame of her becoming pregnant out of wedlock.
I mean, Everett Sloan is a man on the edge from the moment we meet him. I think he's very interesting in this movie.
Well, it's fascinating because he is guarding his daughter's sexuality, but when she becomes pregnant, he does not take it out on her. He puts all the blame on himself, which is unusual, but it makes for some very interesting drama and pathos.
Yeah, I think he does a very good job.
I guess it's a trope that occurs occasionally where the father just... it's Miracle of Morgan's Creek, I think I'm thinking of, where the father recognizes once the dreaded thing happens to his daughter that it was his... He takes the blame on himself instead. And it creates pathos in that movie as well, when the patriarch realizes maybe his own overzealousness created this situation.
Yeah, all of that's going on. And when he does show up at Mitchum's house to have this talk, I mean, of course, he thinks that they're talking about George Hamilton being the father, but later on when he reflects back on it after hearing the sneering words of the town gossips outside of the church, thinks back to that conversation and that patronizing reception he received.
And Mitchum is absolutely horrible in that scene.
Don't try to pawn your damaged goods off on me.
He just completely humiliates this man.
Yeah, and when Everett Sloan thinks back on that
and degrades his daughter.
When he inserts Mitchum into the role of the progenitor of this illicit child, he just can't contain himself anymore. He goes wild, must kill, must exit all polite society. I mean, after that killing rampage, he can't go back home. He's gonna try to hide out in the sulfur swamps. I don't think he's expecting to live long, and George Hamilton and George Peppard fight over who's gonna put him out of his misery. But of course it has to be George Hamilton, because he really has...
Well, he even says, so I have nothing to live for. You exactly. Have the wife and the child. I don't know. It seems like George Hamilton... Do you think he thinks this son really is George Peppard's?
No.
No, but he talks like it is.
Well, because it's true at this point. George Peppard has taken on the father role and
yeah, of course,
is good at it.
George Hamilton is not making any claims to it at all.
No. I think it's really wonderful, because watching it the first time, I was worried, oh, well, now they're going to have the brothers fight for real and hate each other over something, right? Because they both love the same woman, etc., etc. But it never does that. Yes, George Hamilton feels terrible that he's lost this woman because he had to get tangled back up in his parents' family psychodrama. But he never holds it against her or George Peppard. He
adores George Peppard, apparently, yeah, from the beginning, and then worships him once he finds out this injustice that has happened to him. And then, you know, and then Peppard's character, Rafe, he justifies this worship by acting like a saint in terms of the gender tropes.
Yeah.
Of the day, right? By agreeing to marry this woman that is already pregnant and doesn't love him.
Yeah. Every move in this movie works out.
Not agreeing, but volunteering.
It's his idea.
That whole sequence where they meet in the grocery store and then go for coffee and she starts crying. It's such a something that can happen in classical Hollywood cinema every now and then that I find is less frequent in movies afterwards, which is modeling ideal behavior?
Sure. Well, he is a radiant human being, you know, just as much as Shirley MacLaine is in Some Came Running. I mean, they're both saints, although he gets to live.
Well, yeah, he's got it together a lot more than she does.
Yeah.
He does have a place to live. He's learned how to live off the land. He's able to take care of himself.
But they're incredibly good people, and Minnelli doesn't shy away from that. I mean, he embraces that, and he puts both of those characters into those movies, and they're not in the books, as you say. Ginny may as well not be she's not the Ginny in the book. The Ginny in the book is just vicious and horrible, like everyone in that book. And Rafe doesn't exist. So these are Minnelli creations with his screenwriters, and he needs them there to achieve the effects that he wants.
They make the movies, like the movies all come together around these figures, all crystallize around these figures, and they obviously are the moral centers of the movies.
Yeah, and they give it the Lynchian breadth. Right? I mean, when we've talked about David Lynch, we've talked about his facility or his incredible skill at rendering, you know, a vast moral cosmos of amazing goodness and horrifying depravity. Minnelli is doing a lot of that in these movies, too. Certainly feel like Lynch has to have seen these as a kid in the 50s.
Well, we say that about practically every movie we watch, so that it influenced David Lynch. So,
well, the ones that we really like. And seem relevant. Yeah, I think we could talk probably forever about all of these movies, but we've given a good sketch of what you can find in these Minnelli melodramas of various stripes. There are a lot of different flavors of melodrama offered here, but I advise you to sample them all. Should we have a little talk about From Here to Eternity?
Yeah, I wasn't so crazy about it.
Really?
Yeah.
And you had seen it before?
I don't think I had.
You've never seen From Here to Eternity?
Don't think so. Wow, that Burt Lancaster and Deborah Carr relationship, there's not much more showing of it on screen other than that role on the beach. They don't take up a lot of screen time.
No, that's true. I mean, they have a few other moments. I mean, there's a lot going on in this movie. It's another giant book that had to be made manageable in a 2-hour section of time. They did a very good job of adapting it, I think.
So I don't really know how I feel about the movie, other than I very much enjoyed the performances of Burt Lancaster and Frank Sinatra, and Montgomery Clift is always a weirdo. So how do you feel about the movie's conflicted attitude toward the army?
I don't know if it's conflicted as a movie. It's showing human beings who are conflicted about fascistic organizations like the army. It gives you a good sense of why.
Well, of the three characters we care about the most, one of them dies, killed by the army. Two of them, actually. But before Montgomery Clift dies, he and Burt Lancaster pledge their eternal allegiance above their own lives and the women they love to this institution that is shown to be horrible. So how do you feel about that?
I feel like it's a very truthful examination, right? We couldn't have an army if we didn't have a society that produces people who need something like the army to give their lives meaning. Fred Zinnemann was like an arch Hollywood liberal, right? I mean, he's not a militarist.
Yeah, but these characters aren't criticized for that.
They're not criticized. This is a movie that is, and James Jones as well, what he's doing is he's trying to show people to some extent as he believes they are, right? He's trying to show, like, what is it really like to look at the world through the eyes of a person who has no prospects in life, knows the best choice they can make is to enlist in the army, right? Again, these are not draftees. These are 30-year men, as Montgomery Clift puts it. These are professionals. professional soldiers. They chose this option because there was nothing better that American society had to offer.
Right, like being
them.
A sex worker.
Exactly. Well, it's very similar, right? You're putting your body on the line every day and taking a lot of punishment in all kinds of ways, you know, mental and physical. That's what this movie is about. I think it does an incredible job. I mean, obviously, I want to abolish the army. I'd be very happy to do so. But we're not really going to get anywhere unless we abolish the society that creates people who are eager to join up with a professional fascist force like the army. And these are likable people. These are people that you come to care about.
Well, not all of them. Not the guy who's in charge of the... stockade.
Yes, well, of course, there are a lot of people that aren't likable, but there are many that are, and certainly all of our main star performers are characters that you don't agree with them for the most part, but you do come to feel yourself to be at least in sync enough with their life decisions that you can understand the impact of the different events that unfold. I really like Donna Reed's performance in this movie too. She and Sinatra both won supporting actor Oscars for this film. It was famously Sinatra's comeback. You know, that's the one sentence that you always get about this movie, or you get people talking about the beach and they talk about how Sinatra was gone. I mean, he was off the cultural landscape for a couple of years, and this brought him back in a huge way. And of course, by the late 50s, he's one of the biggest stars in Hollywood, bigger than he ever had been in the 40s.
I don't know anything about Donna Reed's career, but I do think every time I have an opportunity to say this on the podcast, I always want to say it, that her performance in It's a Wonderful Life is extraordinary. How many people could, especially such a young actress so early in her career, match Jimmy Stewart in his like greatest and most intense performance? Like match him in intensity.
Well, she does a pretty good job of matching the
Montgomery Clift.
Famously intense Montgomery Clift in this movie too. The most metatextually interesting thing about this movie is, I'm not exactly sure how it lines up, but the life she's talking about leading, the life that her character wants to build for herself in revenge against the people that cast her aside in her hometown, she basically is going to achieve by moving on to TV in the Donna Reed show.
Golfing and go to the country club?
So there is a happy ending in store for her, at least. I think the movie's heart is in her farewell wail as she asks Montgomery Clift, you know, why are you doing this? You can't survive crawling back to the camp in the middle of the Pearl Harbor invasion.
But I don't know, like anyone in the audience could decide to side with him when he says, I'm a soldier.
They could. And again, that's the genius of Zinnemann's presentation of all of this, right? It's presenting characters that have this fidelity to an organization that they shouldn't have. Right? I mean, we see it over and over again. And Burt Lancaster, you know, he's a more grounded and ironized presence in the movie, but he does not believe in the army either. If he did, he would want to be an officer. He would believe that you could actually pull the levers in the army and do some good. He knows you can't. It's very interesting, and especially as an intervention in America so soon after the conclusion of the Good War, World War II, and practically in the midst of the Korean War. And it is not a pretty picture of the army. Anyway, we'll talk a lot more about it when we do our Columbia special subject, I think about 10 years from now.
Oh, God.
Not exactly sure when it is, but we'll have another pass, a full pass at From Here to Eternity. We'll see what Elise thinks of it then. Next week on the podcast, we return to the actress oeuvre vue, Dorothy McGuire. We're going to be watching Gentleman's Agreement from 1947 and Mother Didn't Tell Me from 1950.
Have you seen Mother Didn't Tell Me?
I haven't. Really looking forward to it. Gentleman's Agreement. I think we're going to start to see the difficult side of the Dorothy McGuire persona.
Well, I think we've already
in the ascendant here.
Seen that, but
we have, but we're going to see it even more. So we'll see you then.